ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरि ॐ. We are studying the Brahma Sutras and we studied the commentary of Shankaracharya on the Brahma Sutras till the third sutra. The third sutra is Shastra Yonitvat. So there are two kinds of meanings which could be derived out of the sutra. One is that the scriptures are the source for the means of knowledge of Brahman, or that Brahman is the source of scriptures. So now we come to the first meaning, which has to be analyzed properly, that scriptures lead to the knowledge of Brahman. That is, how do they lead to the knowledge of Brahman? They are the means of knowledge of Brahman. So they lead to the knowledge of Brahman. They are the pramana, means of knowledge. Now here, this has to be established. And so the next sutra, which is Tattu Samanvayat. Tattu Samanvayat. Now this sutra will have the commentary of Shankaracharya, which will establish the meaning that Brahman is the means, scriptures are the means of knowledge of Brahman. So before that, Shankaracharya wants to quash all the other opposing views that might be there regarding this. He starts with the view of Mimamsa. We know that there are six philosophies in India which believe or which follow the Vedas, and so they are called Astika Darshana. They follow the Vedas. They are Yoga, they are Sankhya, Yoga, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Purva Mimamsa or just Mimamsa, and Uttara Mimamsa or Vedanta. Now here, Mimamsa and Nyaya, they are very important for deriving the meaning out of a sentence. Particularly in the case of Vedic sentences, it has been seen that Mimamsa, the school of Mimamsa, they have developed hermeneutical tools. Hermeneutics means a study of meaning. So hermeneutical tools which enable one to understand the meaning of Vedic statements. And that has been done very nicely by Mimamsakas, and who have done this, and Vedantins follow this interpretation, but they have their own Siddhanta, they have their own decision or conclusion regarding the meaning of the Vedas, but they follow this interpretation. They follow this interpretation means they follow this technique of interpretation, which has been developed by Mimamsakas, and also the logical basis which has been developed. Now, here we study what Shankaracharya thinks will be the opposition or the counterpoint by Mimamsaka. So this is a very, very important aspect, and he starts with that. So this is the Purva Paksha Bhashyam. That means the Bhashya which delineates or presents the view of the Purva Paksha, that is the opponent's view. What is it? Katham punaha brahmanaha shastra pramanakatvam uchyate yavata amnayasya kriyarthatvad anarthakyam a tadarthanam iti kriya paratvam shastrasya pradarshitam. The question asked is, katham punaha? Punaha, how again? Again. Punaha again, katham, how? ब्रह्मणः शास्त्र प्रमाणकत्वं उच्यते. अगेन हाउ आर यू टॉकिंग अबाउट द शास्त्र बीइंग मीन्स ऑफ नॉलेज ऑफ ब्रह्मन्? हाउ आर यू सेइंग दैट स्क्रिप्चर्स आर द मीन्स ऑफ नॉलेज फॉर ब्रह्मन्? हाउ कैन यू से दैट? वाई यावता इन एज मच एज or as far as, or because, we can take it as also the meaning of because. Because what? The first chapter of the Purva Mimamsa Sutras, so Sutra number 121, that means 1.2.1, in that we find this particular sutra. What is this sutra? Amnayasya kriyarthatvat anarthakyam a tadarthanam. So amnaya here means scripture. Amnaya here means scripture. So scripture has got kriya arthatvat, because scriptures get their meaning because of kriya, because of sacrificial act of sacrifice. That is the artha, that is the meaning of scripture. So according to Mimamsa, it is very simple that, you see, Mimamsa goes by some kind of basic rules. One is, the meaning of the scripture should be unique and it should not be countered, means it should not become falsified. Anadigata, meaning should be anadigata, means it should not be present somewhere else. And abadita, means it should not be countered, or it should not become wrong. Okay. Anadigata means it has not been studied or it has not been found elsewhere. Abadita means its meaning should not become badita, or it should not get wrong, erroneous, or it should not be countered or quashed or set aside by some other idea. And another thing is prayojanavat. It should have a purpose. Prayojanavat. Purpose. It should be purposeful. So these are the ideas which are basic to a Mimamsa school's understanding of any particular Vedic sentence. Okay, these are the basic things. Now if that is the case, and also here it is told that kriya arthatvat. So a Vedic sentence or scripture becomes scripture because it has as its meaning the performance of a sacrifice which is prescribed by the Vedas. And since the Upanishads or Vedanta do not serve that purpose, so they are bereft of purpose. So anything, any statement of the scripture that does not tell you to perform a sacrifice, they are anarthakyam, they are without any, they are actually meaningless or purposeless. They are meaningless or purposeless. So this is the meaning of the sutra, which is there in the Mimamsa Sutras, which was written by or which was propounded by or written by Jaimini. What is that? Amnayasya kriya arthatvat. Because the meaning of Amnaya or scriptures is the performance of kriya, performance of Vedic sacrifice, anartharkyam a tadarthanam. Those statements which do not have that meaning, a tadarthanam, means which do not have that meaning, meaning of making you perform Vedic sacrifices, they are anartharkyam, they are purposeless. So iti kriyaparatvam shastrasya pradarshitam. So by this sutra, it has been demonstrated. What has been demonstrated? The goal, kriya paratvam, means the fact that sacrificial act or Vedic sacrifice is the purpose of Vedic sentences or Vedic statements has been demonstrated, pradarshitam, by in Shastra. So Shastrasya Kriya Paratvam pradarshitam. The dependence or the goal of scripture being performance of Vedic sacrifices has been demonstrated, has been displayed in this particular sutra. This is whose objection? Mimamsaka's objection. The philosophy of Mimamsa, anybody who is an adherent of the philosophy of Mimamsa, Purva Mimamsa, they are objecting like this. That since Mimamsa Sutra, this Mimamsa Sutra says, Amnayasya Kriyarthatvata Anarthakyam Atadarthanam, it is saying that because the meaning of Vedic sentences is, or scriptures is performance of, or the purpose is performance of Vedic sacrifices, any statement of the scripture which does not have that purpose or meaning is purposeless. So, ataha, therefore, Vedantanam anarthakyam. Vedanta means Upanishads. Vedanta means Upanishads. So, Vedantanam anarthakyam. And therefore, hence, the purposelessness of Vedanta has been established now. Akriyarthatvat. Why? Because they don't say that you have to perform a sacrificial act. So because Upanishadic statements do not make you perform any sacrificial act, they are purposeless. They don't have any purpose. Kartra Devata Adi Prakashana Arthatvena Va Kriya Vidhi Sheshatvam Upasanadi Kriyantara Vidhanarthatvam Va. So, since Upanishads, they don't talk about Vedantic statements having their purpose as Vedic sacrifice, a Kriyarthatvat, they are anarthakyam, they are purposeless. Now, this is one statement which the Mimamsa standpoint gives. But because Vedic statements are important, you see, Vedic statements are Vedic statements, they are the statements of the Vedas. And because Upanishads are part of Vedas, now it is difficult for even Mimamsakas who are Astika, means who believe in the Vedas, it is difficult for them to, or it is not correct for them who consider Vedas to be sacred, to completely set aside Vedic statements. So, they cannot completely say that Vedic statements are completely useless or purposeless. So, they are giving two other options, two or three other options. What are the three options? So, first thing is that these scriptural statements are not asking one to perform any sacrifice. That is clear. So, they are not asking you to do any sacrifice. So, by that logic, they stand purposeless. But how can a Vedic statement or a Vedic sentence be completely purposeless or useless? So, they say, Kartra Devata Adi Prakashana Arthatvena Va. The function of these statements which could be that they try to, you know, prakashana, they try to bring out or delineate, they try to show kartra, the agent, one who does a particular sacrifice, and devata, the deity behind a particular sacrifice, etc. So, it could be what it means is, it could be that these statements are not actually directly telling us what sacrifice to do or how to do, etc. Or they are not talking about Vedic sacrifices. That means they are not talking about Kriya, but they are definitely talking about the context of Vedic sacrifices. So they are talking about who is the agent and who is the deity and other such things. So that way, they are okay, they have some purpose. This is what, because as I told you, there are three important things, principles, in understanding a Vedic sentence according to the Mimamsa philosophy. What are they? One is that it should be anadigata, it should be unique, it should be abadita, it cannot be countered or contradicted, it should be uncontradicted, and it should be prayojanavat, it should have some purpose. So how to bring this purpose? So for bringing purpose, they are saying that, okay, they don't directly tell us to do Vedic sacrifice or some kriya, but they show us or they describe what is the agent, and or who is the agent. They talk about the agent of the sacrifice, and they also talk about the deity of the sacrifice. But again, this is not true with all the Upanishadic passages. So there also there is a problem. This is not true with all the Upanishadic passages. So then there is the next alternative given, that kriya vidhi seshatvam. So they may be also talking about the subsidiary things to a particular Vedic sacrifice. They may not directly talk about the Vedic sacrifice, but they may be talking about subsidiary injunctions for sacrifices, Vedic sacrifices. So, or they may be subsidiary, kriya, vidhi. Vidhi is injunction. Kriya is here Vedic sacrifice. So they may be sheshatvam, they may be subsidiary or ancillary to the Vedic sacrifices. So they either give the context of the person who performs the sacrifices, or the deity behind the sacrifice, or they are the auxiliary texts supporting a Vedic sacrifice. Then there is also the third alternative which is given, and that is upasanadi kriya antara vidhanarthatvam va. So the other alternative which is given is, okay, Upanishads might not talk always about the deity and the agent or the doer of the sacrifice. They may not also be always subsidiary to an injunction, to a vidhi which talks about doing Vedic sacrifice, but they also talk about kriya antara, means different types of performances, not exactly the performance of sacrifice, but kriya antara means different kind of performance. What is the performance? Upasanadi, like contemplation, etc. So if you see Chandogya Upanishad, you will find lot of kind of vidyas in Chandogya Upanishad. Dhara vidya, that vidya, etc., where you meditate on different aspects of the universe in order to meditate on Brahman. That is Saguna Brahma Upasana. So Upasana means contemplation. Adi, why Adi? So contemplation includes, means here they want to talk about meditation also, meditation, etc. So Upanishads do talk about that. Vidhana Arthatvam. So there again, it is considered by this Mimamsaka as they are injunctions. They are injunctions. So they are injunctions to do what? They are even Upanishadic passages are injunctions to do the contemplation and meditation, etc. So the Mimamsakas, because they want to hold the sacred nature of the Vedas, they are giving three alternatives. That yes, Upanishads do not talk about performance of sacrifices, Vedic sacrifices, but they talk about the context in terms of the agent and also the deity, etc., and other things of a sacrifice. Or they talk about, now all Upanishads don't talk about such things. So they say they talk about also subsidiary things connected to the performance of a sacrifice. Or they also talk about other kinds of... So, The Mimamsa propel or impel a person to do Vedic sacrifice. That is why they are purposeless, anarthakyam. They are purposeless. Why? Because akriyarthatvat, because of their not having the purpose of a Vedic sacrifice. But because Mimamsakas, they hold the Vedas as sacred, because they are belonging to the philosophy of Mimamsa or Purva Mimamsa, which is a Astika Darshana, which is the philosophy which believes in the Vedas. So they give alternative explanations to the statements of Vedanta, which do not directly ask us to perform a Vedic sacrifice. But there should be some meaning. It cannot be completely purposeless. Why? Because they are, after all, Vedic statements. So Vedic statements cannot be completely purposeless. So what are they saying? They say that kartra devata adi prakashanarthatvena va. So there is an alternative understanding of the purpose of Vedantic statements. Means Vedantic statements, that is the Upanishadic statements. What is that? That they may be statements which delineate or establish the agent, the doer of the Vedic sacrifice, and also the deity of the Vedic sacrifice, and other such things related or relevant to Vedic sacrifices. But this is one of the alternatives, because not all Upanishadic passages might be delineating the agent and also the deity and other related things of a Vedic sacrifice. Then they say kriya vidhi sheshatvam. So these Vedantic statements could also point to some auxiliary or subsidiary things related to the injunction of sacrifice, kriya vidhi. So they might be also pointing to some kind of a thing or some kind of a knowledge which is subsidiary to the performance of Vedic sacrifice. And the third alternative which they give is upasanadi kriya antara vidhanarthatvam va. So in the Upanishads we see there are a lot of meditations, contemplations on different kinds of meditations, on different kinds of aspects of this universe. So vidhana means injunction. So it could be that Vedas are giving injunctions in the form of meditation, upasanadi. So meditation, contemplation, etc. And they are kriya antara, means they are different form of sacrifice. They are not sacrifice, but they are something connected with the sacrifice. So you meditate, etc. Or you contemplate, etc. So that is what is being told here. So here we have to understand that in the beginning itself, Shankaracharya is bringing this objection, because in the previous sutra, Shastra Yunitvat, there came two meanings, that scriptures are the source of the means of knowledge of Brahman, or Brahman is the source of all scriptures. And in the first meaning is here contended upon, that how is it possible that the scriptures can be the source of means of knowledge of Brahman? And this Shankaracharya is thinking that this could be one objection which the Mimamsakas can bring. And that is why Shastra Pramanaka Brahma, how is it that Brahman, the means of knowledge of Brahman is scriptures? That is being, that as a big objection is being brought out. And why is this objection brought out? Because Yavata, means as much as, in as much as, you see, Mimamsakas are bringing this objection because in as much as the sutra of the Jaiminiya Mimamsa Sutras, Amnayasya Kriyarthatvat, Anarthakyam Atadarthanam. So those statements, Vedic statements, because amnayasya kriyatattva, because the scriptures get their purpose by injunctions of Vedic sacrifices, and when there is no Vedic sacrifice, atadarthanam, if the meaning is not towards performance of a Vedic sacrifice, then anarthakyam, then they become meaningless or purposeless. Here again we saw this comes from the Mimamsaka principle of any means of knowledge being valid only if it is anadigata. So it is something which has not been known earlier. Abhadita, it cannot be contradicted, and prayojanavat, it has got some purpose. So any means of knowledge becomes a valid means of knowledge. Any pramana becomes pramanya, means valid means of knowledge, only when it is anadigata, abhadita, and prayojanavat. This is the principle, this is the maxim, or this is the kind of rule which Mimamsakas follow. And by that rule, Upanishads or Vedanta statements, Vedantic statements, they are aprayojanavat. They don't seem to have an apparent purpose, apparently. And so that is where the problem starts. And so we see that because Mimamsakas, they hold Vedas in high regard, for them Vedas are sacred, they give us this particular three alternatives where they say that okay, the Vedas might be talking about different kinds of things which are subsidiary to the sacrifice. For example, the agent and the deity, etc. That is one thing. And the second thing is that they might be talking about different types of upasanas. They might be talking about different types of upasanas, or they might be talking about some kind of subsidiary element which is connected to a Vedic sacrifice. Now, there is one statement which is very famous. Vedosharaha Vedantaha. Vedosharaha Vedantaha. So this is what Mimamsaka says. Ushara means desert. Ushara means desert. So Vedo Usharaha means in Vedas, Vedanta is like desert. Why? Because Vedanta does not ask you to perform any Vedic sacrifice. So anything that does not make you perform any sacrifice is like a desert and purposeless. This is what is told by the Mimamsakas. This is a general statement which you will find many places quoted. Vedo Sharaha Vedantaha. Vedo Sharaha Vedantaha. Means Veda Usharaha Vedantaha. Okay, so next we will see how this again, there is another kind of aspect of this objection which is also brought forth. So, and also how the objection is analyzed by Shankaracharya. This objection is analyzed by Shankaracharya in the next paragraph. We will see that. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat.